Thank you, everybody, for coming to the Aaron Torres Podcast YouTube page. I do have one quick favor before we get to the video that you came here for, and that is very simply this. You see that little red subscribe button below this video? Go ahead, smash that subscribe button. It really does help me. It really does help this channel grow and my audience grow. So go ahead and hit that red subscribe button. And now, here is the video that you came here for. Let's get into the topic of the day, which frankly might be the biggest topic in all of college basketball right now, and that is the state of the Duke Blue Devils. Duke actually came into this week on a little bit of a hot streak. They had won two in a row coming into Monday night, had beaten Georgia Tech, beaten Clemson, and you kind of think maybe they're turning a corner, maybe they are finally positioning themselves to make a serious run towards an NCAA tournament bid. Instead, the exact opposite happens Monday night. They go to Miami as an 11-point favorite against a Miami team with seven scholarship players who are eligible. Everybody else is out with either COVID, with injuries, with whatever. And Duke loses outright. Final score, 77-75. Again, to a Miami team that had seven scholarship players and came into this game 6-10 overall. And so when you look at Duke's resume coming out of this game, again, it felt like maybe they were turning a corner, but now with the loss, we could just essentially throw some dirt on the grave of Duke because it ain't pretty. Overall, Duke is 7-6 this season. They are 1-3 in games away from Cameron Indoor Arena. And most importantly, they are 0-4 in quad one games. Quad one are the biggest games against the best opponents and the biggest measuring stick that the NCAA tournament committee uses to determine who gets at-large teams as well as seeding in the NCAA tournament. Duke has not beaten a single elite opponent anywhere, home, road, neutral, whatever, in college basketball this season. And so because of it, let's just be honest. As of right now, as I record here on February 2nd, Punxsutawney Phil, Groundhog Day, Punxsutawney Phil looked at his shadow, and he saw six more weeks of really bad basketball for Duke. Duke is not, don't listen to what who's on TV, don't listen to what people are saying. As of right now, Duke is not only not in the NCAA tournament, they're not even close. As I said, not a single relevant win this season, according to the computer metrics that matter, according to the NCAA. And so while I could sit here for the next 4, 5, 6 minutes and just kind of, you know, make fun of Coach K, I mean, I should have some sympathy for him, some empathy, right? He wants me to have some empathy. Don't you dare ask him what you're going to do moving forward. But neither here nor there, I'm going to put that aside because it'd be easy to just rag on Coach K, rag on Duke for the next few minutes, which I could easily do, which many of you would enjoy. But instead, I'm going to do the exact opposite. What I'm going to do is actually take a real deep dive into what is wrong with Duke. What has happened, and why did we get to this situation, right? There are so many things when it comes to these conversations. We always talk about the what. Duke stinks. But the better question is why. Why does Duke stink? How did they get so bad so fast? They were trending towards a 2 or a 3 seed in last year's NCAA tournament before it was canceled. Were good enough to win it with Trey Jones, with Vernon Carey, with Cassius Stanley. So what happened? How did it get so bad? Let's get into the why. And as I looked at this, I kind of came up with 5 reasons why Duke is struggling the way that they are. The first one, the most important one, it's the reality of this college basketball season. It is the COVID-19 stuff. And I know what everyone's going, oh, Duke is dealing with it like everybody else. I'm not arguing that. I'm not saying that other teams haven't had issues. Look, Baylor has shut down because of COVID. They're still awesome. Gonzaga has shut down because of COVID. They're still awesome. You go on and on down the list. Florida State just shut down this week. They're still good. Virginia's atop the ACC. They shut down. So that's not an excuse for Duke. And by the way, none of these things are excuses. They're reality. But when it comes to COVID, what's important to remember is what I have been trying to tell you on this YouTube channel and on my podcast, the Aaron Torres Podcast, all year. Younger teams with more freshmen and fewer returnees, those are the teams right now that are underachieving and having real problems getting through this COVID era. It isn't just Duke, by the way. Michigan State is not going to make the NCAA tournament the way that they're playing as they get set to play Iowa on Tuesday night. Kentucky is not going to make the NCAA tournament the way that they're playing. Kansas is going to make the tournament, but they are definitely headed in the wrong direction. North Carolina appears to have righted the ship, but they haven't played the top half of the ACC yet, so it's really hard to know. But when you look at Duke specifically, first of all, they only had four returnees off last year's roster. And really, outside of Matt Hurt and Jordan Goldwire, none of them played very much, right? Wendell Moore was hurt a lot last year. You look at everybody else on this roster, they are new. Joey Baker was, of course, on the roster. I forget if last year he was supposed to redshirt, he did it, whatever. He barely played as well. And so you look at a team that had only four returnees, none of them would be considered quote-unquote stars, the way that you think of, say, Corey Kispert at Gonzaga as a star, Jared Butler at Baylor as a star. None of them were considered stars, and instead, they're all freshmen. And so this COVID era continues to wreak havoc on these teams for a number of reasons that are actually perfectly explainable for all of you. And I know all of you listening love basketball. But for any of us who have played basketball, the reason Duke's struggling is because the way that anybody struggles when you're with a bunch of new guys or girls that you don't know, right? This is part of the problem of the COVID era for these young teams. Less practice time, fewer exhibitions, and no exhibitions, as a matter of fact, fewer games in the preseason to get right, start and stop nature of the season. You got to quarantine. You got to be away from your teammates. The teams, for the most part, that are having success are the teams that already know each other, that have played together, that are comfortable with each other. And it's the teams like Duke, the teams like Michigan State, the teams like Kentucky that are bringing in a lot of new pieces, that are trying to figure things out, that can't get things right, in practice and need more exhibition time and need more game time against bad teams. Those are the teams that are struggling. Duke is no exception, and as much as anybody, they needed a full offseason of workouts. They needed those early cream puff games. They had a few more than Kentucky, but not enough where they got things right as they got to ACC play. The second thing, they're just not as good as a normal Duke team. And again, it sounds like an excuse. Oh, you're just making excuses for Coach K. Torres. I'm not making excuses, but the bottom, and it's like I tell you all the time, before we get to the bottom line, it's like I tell you all the time, in life, there are reasons and there are excuses. And this is an actual reason. And the reason why is very simple. In the history of college basketball, we all understand that when you rely on freshmen, you need the truly, 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 truly elite guys, or your season's going to be, it's not going to make a difference, right? This is no disrespect to the 10th, 12th, 15th, 18th ranked player in the country, but you look at the players that have an impact as freshmen and help teams win games. It is the transcendent players that do that. Zion Williamson at Duke, Anthony Davis at Kentucky, John Wall at Kentucky, Derrick Rose at Memphis, Cade Cunningham this year at Oklahoma State, and you know what else those other teams have had? They've usually had good veterans around those players that have helped the young players adjust to college basketball. Now, not every one of those teams, but Anthony Davis had Darius Miller, who played in the NBA. John Wall had Patrick Patterson, who still plays in the NBA 11 years after they left Kentucky. Duke had Quinn Cook, who is still in the NBA on their 2015 team. Duke this year simply is not as talented as they've been in years past, and they don't have the veteran depth. Want me to prove it? I'll give you some analytics to prove it. Like I said, if you don't have those top three, top five ranked recruits, you're going to struggle. Well, look at Duke's recruiting class this year. Jalen Johnson is the highest ranked recruit in this class. He is the 13th ranked player in the country, according to the high school recruiting rankings from last year, 24/7 Sports. Beyond him, Jeremy Roach was ranked 23rd. DJ Stewart was ranked 26th. Mark William was ranked 28th. Not saying those guys aren't good. Not saying they can't make an impact in college basketball down the road. Not saying they couldn't make an impact as role players on good teams this year. But when you ask those guys to carry a program, it's going to be a struggle. In the sophomore class, Matthew Hurt was the 12th ranked player in his class. I don't think it's ironic that as the 12th ranked player in the class, he was not a one-and-done guy. He's back as a sophomore. He's an NBA talent, and now as a sophomore, he is by far this team's best player. Wendell Moore, the 29th ranked player in his class. And so when you sit there and say Duke doesn't have the talent that it has had, that is the bottom line absolute truth. If you don't believe me, just go back to the year that Duke had Zion Williamson. Zion Williamson's class had R.J. Barrett, who was the consensus number one player in that class, Cam Reddish, and Zion Williamson, who in some order were ranked three of the top five prospects in that high school class in that specific season. Those are three of the top five players in that class. And that is why Duke had so much success. By the way, 2 years before, Harry Giles and Jason Tatum, the consensus, two of the top five players in that class. The Marvin Bagley year, 2017, when they made the Elite Eight. Wendell Carter, Trayvon Duval, and Marvin Bagley were all ranked in the top 10. Marvin Bagley was the number one player in that class and the number two pick overall. Those are difference makers. Those are X-factor guys. Those are guys that can come in as freshmen and completely dominate. No disrespect to Jalen Johnson or anyone on this team, but they are just not the same caliber of player. And really quick, as an example, let me give you an example that might make more sense. Think about it from the NBA perspective. Think about the difference between the team that has the number one pick in the draft and, say, the number 13 pick in the draft, right? So we're comparing the number one high school player in the class and the difference that they can make, say, like a Cade Cunningham versus guys in the teens at the college level. But think about it at the NBA level. Kyrie Irving's been a number one pick. Anthony Davis, number one pick. Zion, number one pick. These are guys that are stars, that are difference makers. The 13th pick in the draft? Now, you can get a superstar in that range. Giannis was taken in that range. But as a general rule, you want a superstar that's going to change things right away? You got to have the number one overall pick. Since I'm going long here, let's make the last three topics really quick. First of all, number three on my list, the ACC is actually improved this year. Now, they're not saying they're great. I'm not saying they're even good. But relative to last year, remember, last year, there were essentially four teams that were going to make the NCAA tournament out of the ACC. There was Duke with Trey Jones and all those guys. Louisville was good. Florida State was really good. And Virginia came on late. And those were probably the only four teams that were going to make the NCAA tournament. NC State was kind of on the bubble, sort of going into the ACC tournament, but they were no lock. Syracuse was terrible. North Carolina had the worst team in school history, essentially, last season. The ACC was really down. This year, I'm not saying it's good, but it's better. According to Joe Lunardi's last bracket, six teams in the ACC are going to the NCAA tournament. Virginia, Virginia Tech, North Carolina, Florida State, Clemson, and Louisville. Six teams. On top of that, Syracuse is playing well. They've won three of their last four. Pitt is on the bubble. NC State is on the bubble. You have teams that are just better across the board in the ACC. I don't think it's a coincidence that Duke's first few losses in the ACC, you know what happened? They lost at Louisville in a game that they could have won but didn't. Louisville's a tournament team. They lost at Virginia Tech to a tournament team. Now, they lost to Pitt. Pitt is not currently trending as a tournament team, but they were until last week, till they went on a losing streak. And so when I look at Duke's schedule, they've basically lost to teams that are going to make the NCAA tournament since they've gotten to conference play. And so I'm not making excuses for them, but the conference is better. It's also a big reason why it's hard to envision Duke getting any better when they still have two games against North Carolina, Virginia, Syracuse, etc. left on the schedule. Number four, it's a basketball thing. They play like a young team, and they don't do the little things right. What do I mean by that? Well, coming into the year, they didn't really have a point guard. They tried Jordan Goldwire there, but he's not really the guy. Now they've tried Jeremy Roach, and he's gotten better. But they are still a team, a young team that turns the ball over, that does dumb things that young teams do that hurt young teams. I just mentioned turning the ball over. Duke averages about 13 and a half turnovers per game. That might not sound terrible. It's not great, though. I'll give you an example. Virginia and Villanova both average 8 turnovers a game. Duke averages close to 14. So think about that. That is 6 fewer possessions that Duke no longer has because they give the ball to the other team, which in many cases leads to transition points and baskets, and at the very least is 6 less possessions than a Duke, than a Virginia that you have to actually score the basketball. Now, in theory, you don't want to turn the ball ever, but you can get it down to 6, 7, 8 times. You're going to have a lot better success than 13, 14, 15 times. They also don't shoot the 3 ball well. This was kind of an incredible stat to me. They're shooting 33% as a team, but their best player is Matt Hurt. Matt Hurt is shooting 42% from 3 alone. And if you take out his 3-point attempts, 42%, Duke is shooting 30% as a team. When you turn the ball over 13 and a half, 14 times, and you shoot 30% from 3 outside of your best player, you're not going to win very many games. And finally, the last reason is because they're Duke. They get everybody's best shot every night, no different than Kentucky. You wonder how Kentucky loses to Georgia. It's because Georgia is geeked up for the Kentucky game more than they are the Ole Miss or the Texas A&M or the Florida game. No disrespect to Texas A&M basketball fans if you're listening, but it's the truth. People are fired up to play Kentucky. People are fired up to play Kansas in the Big 12. People are fired up to play Gonzaga in their conference. And people are fired up to play Duke. You think Miami is going to go bananas with seven scholarship players on everybody? Or you think they are just really excited to play Duke? You notice how Pitt has lost four straight games since they played Duke, since they beat Duke? Not a coincidence. Everybody's geeked up to play Duke. And so when you look at this situation at Duke, that is why they are struggling so much. One, because of all the COVID stuff that impacted them more than anybody. Two, their team just isn't as good as it used to be, or it usually is. And by the way, they got a good recruiting class coming in next year. Three, the ACC has improved across the board. Not saying it's great, but it's better. Four, they don't do the little things well. And five, they're Duke, and they get everybody's best shot. I don't believe that this thing is going to turn around. Two games coming up against North Carolina, game against Louisville, game against Virginia. But I'll tell you this. Right now, things are not good for Duke. They are not trending to be an NCAA tournament team. And if you want to know why you're struggling, I just told you why.